ladies and gentlemen. Namaste. I am Daksh. I'm the founder of Blub World Magazine. A very warm welcome to all of you to the Blub World Web Talk 76th episode. In the last 75 episodes on this very platform, nearly 1,000 plus school leaders have participated, shared their opinions, ideas, innovations, observations on how is education changing during the lockdown and what do we perceive to be the changes that are going to happen in what we teach and what students learn in the coming times, because what we see right now is a big forced upon education technology implementation, which was no one's choice, but now it's the first choice that everybody has. So when we experience such an overwhelming existential crisis as a community, as a society, this is a time when we as people become more empathetic, we become more receptive, we are ready to listen, we are ready to experiment. And this is the very reason why we created this platform, because every section of the society contributes to society with its own capabilities. As educationists and education leaders, till now we were just supposed to be responsible for deciphering education or delivering knowledge. But this pandemic has given us a completely new role, which has become super critical right now. And that new role is to create the knowledge bank that the world would need in the future. Because what we are witnessing, our future generations will be looking towards us to find out that what were we doing? Because these observations, these reactions, these behavioral changes would become the basis of innovation in the coming times. So I hope you've experienced the pandemic, helped your students keep their anxiety at bay, kept the school running, kept the teaching learning process running. So before we initiate the platform, just a bit build an understanding about this, it's a virtual roundtable. So we expect all of you to speak. And since it's a timed session, we would request everybody to please stick to the time limit, just so that, you know, it's comfortable for everybody. You can all see Divya Purohit on your screen. So Divya is the timekeeper. So once your 2 minutes of speaking are over, he'll put his one hand up. And then you have 30 more seconds to conclude. And once your 2 minutes and 30 seconds are over, he'll put his second hand up. And that is the time that you might get muted. If you get muted, please don't get offended. It is just to finish this activity on time so that none of your schedules get disturbed. So this is a bilingual platform, so you can use either English or Hindi. But if you use a third language, I won't get it. It's not a problem at all. But try sticking to these two languages, and preferably English, because we have people here even from outside of India. So it's more easy for them to comprehend and contribute. Try to stick to English, but Hindi is not at all a problem. You can use it, because one thing that we know for sure, bhasha kabhi bhi gyan ka paimana nahi hoti. Language is never the base for knowledge. So knowledge can be deciphered in any language that you seem and deem comfortable. So use the language which you're comfortable with, but preferably try to use English. So I hope you enjoy the next 20-30 minutes here, where we engage and try to know what do you think are and will be the skills of the future. And when I say skills of the future, there are two aspects to it. The first is the kind of skills that we'll teach to our students. And second, what kind of skills do our teachers need? Because when we talk of future skills, we must understand technology is there everywhere. A lot of jobs are now no more existent. And just to share an observation, the definition of a school, the way we know it, has already been obliterated. The institution that we are going to reopen would need a completely new definition, because they will now be much more about facilitating, observing, and trying to understand what better and good can we do with our students. So thank you so much once again for taking out the time and being here with us. A very warm welcome to the Blub World Web Talks 76th edition. Let's know it from all of you on our skills, or the skills that we need in the future. With every session, we have one special speaker who is typically somebody not very much involved in schools to give a bird's eye view of the learning teaching process. So today we have with us Mr. Rishikesh Patankar, Chief Operating Officer, Education Skills and CSC Academy, CSC E-Governance Services India Limited from New Delhi. Rishikesh ji, over to you to initiate this session for the next 4 minutes. Over to you, sir.
Good morning all, and I welcome all the teachers as well as participants. Thank you, everyone. In fact, Education and skill development both have changed, and pre-COVID and post-COVID, there have been a lot of changes which we are seeing continuously. So I think the most important skill right now is the fourth industrial revolution technologies. I think the technologies like artificial intelligence, deep learning, these technologies would be the future. And I think a lot of schools have actually implemented such kind of facilities in their teaching learning processes. The schools or the institutions who were ready with MIS or maybe a web portal or maybe a learning management system, I think that they had an edge over the schools who didn't had such infrastructure or IT infrastructure or other things in place. Other most important factor is how a teacher is trained. So the teacher, if they are IT savvy and they are able to use various technologies for teaching learning, that is, I think, ideal situation. And I think most of the schools have such kind of faculties who are able to basically put in quality time. And I respect all the teachers because they have been very enthusiastic and successful in terms of taking lectures and giving small inputs to the children so that all the children are able to understand and grow together. In fact, in Indian scenario, teaching is little difficult, and you find that in a sort of classroom there are many students who have different pace of learning. So each student's assessment is different, each student's ability to understand is different. So we need to have a personalized kind of learning so that we are able to teach a particular student how they pace it and how they learn it. So that is the most important aspect. And IT technologies have seriously helped in this situation also, where the system basically identifies the student's pace and is able to control the student's pace and is able to give the content in a proper format. But in a general classroom where there are 30-40 students and only one teacher, so situation is little difficult but manageable. We are basically managing all that. Then the important aspect is the skill factor, because a lot of students basically move from schools to maybe pursue further studies or maybe join some vocational institutions in order to pursue their career. But most important factor is giving them life skills so that they become learners for the whole life. That is the most important idea, I think. And during COVID also, we have what we have understood is people who had good IT skills were able to move ahead. So that is the positive aspect which has come. And I think that has been appreciated well. But most important is whether the students are motivated enough. So that is also an issue. Sometimes I see many children are not motivated enough in order to learn, and they see online learning maybe as a kind of burden given to them. But I think there are mixed opinions on that. But and we had been talking about the Bloom's taxonomy as well as the blended learning approach. And I think this has been forced. The COVID has forced us to use all the different approaches. And recently, the MHRD's announcement that a new education policy has come and quality education would be given to all. And you have flexibility in order to learn. You can pursue two courses at the same time. So I think that is a brilliant idea. And as a maybe an engineering student can pursue an arts course, maybe a commerce student can do a course in AI. I think that is the way. But technology-wise and skill-wise, I think artificial intelligence and the technologies which are related to fourth industrial revolution are here to stay. And they have a lot of ambit because they are not only applicable in education, but in the other areas as well, like marketing, healthcare, livelihoods. So that is the most important aspect. That is basically the through which a student makes their career. So thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Rishikesh. To summarize what you said and the way you put the whole discussion to context, that this is typically the fourth tech or industrial revolution that we are seeing. And as an economy, we are right now moving from an industrial economy to a knowledge-based economy. And at this point, skills get super critical, observation skills get critical, experience gets critical. Schools who were ready with IT infrastructure got a greater advantage. Teachers were really enthusiastic and teachers took it on them, and you know, just they learned at a pace which even they could not imagine that they could do. And they adapted so well to it. Different pace of learning needs personalized learning. Personalized learning has been easier and typically got enablement through technology. But it also got a new challenge that in a virtual classroom, you don't know who are the backbenchers. So you don't know whom to focus on and whom to actually, you know, find or get a feedback from that whether teaching and learning is happening or not. Tech really helped in continuous learning. Mass teaching is now difficult. Again, the same scenario. It's when you get onto a platform like this or a virtual classroom, it's typically one-on-one teaching. And the other ones might not be learning. So that's a question that remains unanswered. Life skills for enabling lifelong learning, keeping students motivated, Bloom's taxonomy and blended learning. A lot of new pedagogical changes, jo cheeze, what I think were only a part of syllabus of the teachers, has now become applied in real life. And that's where they're learning the real aspects of education. A multidisciplinary approach for learning after the announcement of the new National Education Policy for India. We are right now seeing how intertwined education is, and we are actually trying to understand that this is the way it should be taught, because you cannot teach in isolation and subject silos. You will have to blend it all together and find a much more engaging approach towards teaching and learning. One of the school leaders some time back shared a very nice statement. So I'm just copying it from him and sharing it with all of you. He said that technology education ka wo bachcha hai jo ab bada ho gaya hai aur jisne pure ghar ki zimmedari le li hai. So technology is a child of education, and right now it has actually grown to take up the responsibility of the whole education family. We are right now learning through education. And just to share one more piece of information that we got, we had a behavioral scientist on this very platform, Colonel Sudeep Mukherjee, who shared a recent research that a student who's looking on a screen like this has an attention span of only 8 seconds. On every 9th second, you have lost him and he has started daydreaming. So the kind of stickiness that you want in your content is something very critical, and you'll have to work on this. Let's hear it from the next guest for today, Mr. Mark Pollitt, Principal, Ministry of Education, Abu Dhabi, UAE. Mark, it's over to you for the next 2 minutes. Please unmute your audio. You're muted. Yeah.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody, and thank you for inviting me. Education, as we've already heard this morning, has taken significant changes over this last 6 months. 6 months has completely destroyed education that we have. What was our comfort zone? What was our students' comfort zone? But it was a necessary requirement. We were at a point in our education systems throughout the world where we needed to change from knowledge acquisition to skill acquisition. Workplaces, business people, no matter who you speak to, are requesting that students are no longer able to recite every element of the periodic table, but they're able to take that knowledge they have and actually put it into practice. I'm 46 years old. I've had multiple careers. If I go back to when I was born, the workforce at the time was a workforce that was told what to do, how to do it, and they did it. We come 46 years on, and we have a workforce that this last 6 months has been completely changed. We have multiple industries working from home. We have companies closing down offices saying, well, actually, we don't need them. Our employees can work from home and we're getting greater productivity. This is where we need to be as an education body, to actually provide our students with the skills to do this. However, we have had numerous years of development of education where our teachers have only learned to deliver knowledge. The aspects of changing people's perspectives, teaching cognitive flexibility, digital literacy, emotional and social intelligence. Yeah? These are skills that we have, as teachers, have up until recently not had to address. As a teacher, I think the key part that we've got to have is a creative and innovative mindset. As a school principal, as leaders of schools, we have to instill that in our staff to ensure that our students are able to achieve the necessary skills, the necessary confidence that they can take on board responsible positions within society and move forward. We are providing students with the skills, not for jobs that exist now, but but the jobs that will exist in 5-10 years' time. This is where we have to be, and this is our key focus, is what we have to achieve is to ensure that our students have every necessary element of what is required to progress in life. We go back to, you know, again, if we reflect back, over the last 50 years, our workforce has changed. We were a predominant workforce back 50 years ago, and now we have robotic workforce. Yeah. We have changed that. We have changed in 50 years. The technology that was available, my very first computer 35 years ago, was a Commodore VIC-20. I had to program it to do anything. Now I have a smartphone that I'm talking to people from across the world that is doing so many more, million times more, has million times more power than anything that we expected 40 years ago. Education, educators need to change, just like technology has changed. And without that change, we are not going to be able to take our students forward. Platforms that have been referred to, like Microsoft Teachers, Microsoft Education, Apple Education, Google Classroom, these are all tools that allow us to provide students with access to a teacher. But it's our responsibility not just to sit in front of people, like I am now, telling people what to do, talking to people, but it's our responsibility to give the students control, to be able to pass over, right, how do we learn? How do we move forward? How do we develop it? If a student comes back with a completely different way of doing a problem, a mathematics problem, it's not...
Thank you so much, Mark. The time was over. We'll try to come back to you if it's possible. But yes, to summarize what all you said, that multiple careers is now the reality. And the way the workforce has changed is drastic and dramatic at the same time. And the kind of jobs that we'll be having 10 years down the line is something that we have to imagine right now, build curriculums right now, build skilling curriculums right now, because we need very different kind of people in the workforce in the next, even what I would say, in the next even 5 years. Because a lot of jobs that humans used to do where we found redundant skills being used are now being taken over either by machine learning, artificial intelligence, or some kind of blockchain technology that's getting put into place. So changing people's perspectives is what was very important. And it typically happened as a society, we changed and evolved quite fast. Emotional skills will become more and more critical because machine learning cannot give that or will ever have that. That's what we hope for, that it does not get evolved to such a level that a human becomes useless. And from books to smart boards to smartphones, now we are on a single device where all kinds of teaching, learning, engagement, entertainment, all our aspects of life are being served by a small little device that we have in our hands. So we need to think on how would we as humans evolve and as societies engage in the coming times with technology and without technology even. So let's now listen to the next guest for today, Ms. Abhilasha Singh, Principal, Shining Star International School, Abu Dhabi, UAE. Abhilasha, over to you for the next 2 minutes.
Thank you so much, Daksh, and good morning to everyone present here. That's just one aspect of when you said that technology will govern us. I mean, we should not reach a situation where technology starts governing us. Well, I suppose technology, we understand that technology is here to stay. Artificial intelligence has made its way into that foray, and we are hit by this, and especially so the understanding has come within the last 6 months that we have moved to online learning. But at the same time, you know, there are other subjects as well. So it's not that everybody has to move now. There's a rat race for technology-based courses. No, we have to equip our students. We have to empower them with these skills, but not to neglect the other social sciences that are very important and are going to play a very important role in keeping the world stable. Because it should not be that we are tipping towards technology and then we're leaving the other aspects of society bare and nobody to take care of that area. And here we have global citizenship, which is a very important skill that the children have to develop. So not just leading the children to just one one area of learning. And I love the report that WEF has released, which Mr. Rishikesh also has referred to, the Education 4.0. And are we preparing our students for the fourth industrial revolution? And very categorically, the WEF and OECD have stated that there are four skills which are going to be very important. And we have to shift the learning content in that area. And interpersonal skills, global citizenship, technology, and innovation and creativity. Now, with the our education policy being reframed, and we have also seen that I just picked up one line from the report, National Education Policy, and this was very heartful. It said, keep learning joyful. And this is something that even the CBSE Secretary, Mr. Tripathi, also has said, that keep learning joyful. And that's where, you know, the connect with the students, like we mentioned over here, that the children, we are not able to connect with them because the screen is here. And that really has become very difficult to engage the students in our learning. And this is going to continue because we are in Abu Dhabi, in UAE, well, in some Emirates, everybody is has to come to school. But in Abu Dhabi, we have been given the option of distance learning and online learning. So can you imagine the craziness that the principals are going through at the moment, planning how the bubbles are going to work, and at the same time. So teacher empowerment is again a very important aspect over here. The national education policy also, with the new things coming. So the thing is that if we are going to again base our learning, which is assessment driven, and the policy also says that the board exams have to be low stake. So there is another aspect.
Abhilashaji, the time was actually over. Again, to summarize what all you said, but we'll try to come back to if it's possible, if the time allows, that tech is here to stay, that's for sure. And we are actually right now meddling to understand how to tame tech at this point, because most of the people who have started selecting platforms or even enabling platforms within their schools, they were not tech savvy people. So the process of selecting a platform was even very new to them. So as an educator, as a school leader, one part of your administrative decision making is to now select a technology atmosphere or ecosystem where you want to introduce your kid to, because technology has its own impact on the personality and your way of learning. And rat race for tech based courses, this is something very, very important. We in this wave have actually lost the absolute sensibility of education. We are not looking at all the aspects of it. Since we are fascinated by it, even the elders and the leaders and the educators, our fascination is driving the current decision making, which is not good for a healthy education ecosystem. We should actually keep looking at all the other aspects which are impacting, because we are trying to create people who come together to build a society, not some kind of a human factory that works to give good output. So we need to understand that human life and human factor also find some space, and not to neglect the social sciences. Are we preparing for the fourth change or the fourth wave of change that's happening all around us with the kind of skills that you already said, interpersonal skills, creativity, global citizenship, keeping learning joyful. One of the observations, or one very important thing, because right now this is the only option. We do not have a fear circuit right now working in a classroom where a student is ready to learn. You will have to use a reward circuit in his mentality so that he learns and becomes an active learner. Because the persona of a teacher and the discipline of a school might not work in a virtual classroom. And that's where you need to give him some kind of a reward so that he becomes an active learner, or at the end of the day, enjoys learning. And teacher empowerment, assessment-driven learning has to change. And I think even the policy has stated that yes, assessments should be low stake and there should be other modes that should go on. Abhilashaji is putting her hand up. I'll try to give you some time, but not right now. Okay, please take a minute. You're muted.
Carrying on to what you referred to, classrooms have to be made places for social good. Technology, and especially at the moment, education technology for social good. So I believe, and this is where my work also is with my students, activism, advocacy, and action. And as a sustainable development goal ambassador, these are wonderful, like when we look at global citizenship and the skill development, now is the time and nothing like before. So these, I have seen this as a period of opportunity rather than, you know, a challenge. So we have made very good use of it. We've invited speakers to the morning assemblies from abroad, and this has really kept learning very engaging and also joyful. So education technology for social good. This is something like, you know, if we come back to it, if we can have a discussion on that later, I would really like to, I would love it. Thank you.
Absolutely, Abhilashaji. So EdTech for social good, and what we can observe right now, we have talked to nearly 1,000+ school leaders like this. And one thing that we know for sure, we are all using EdTech not for solving education issues. We are using EdTech to solve communication issues, because that's how far we've actually come with technology. We right now need to understand all its aspects, that it's not just a communication platform. It's something more than that, and we need to understand all the aspects of it. So let's listen to the next speaker for today, Ms. Sandhya Venkatesh, Principal Mount Letra Z School, Vasco, Goa. Sandhya, ma'am, over to you for the next 2 minutes.
Good morning, all. When the topic was given to me, and most of the aspect Mr. Rishikesh has touched, even Abhilash has touched, what main skills we need to develop is creativity, which was already there, but now it is technological driven creativity. Emotional intelligence also plays a very important role. Critical thinking, which we were thinking that we need to develop in our children, and we are trying to develop, again, from a distance, we have to work on that. Active learning mindset, growth mindset is very important in today's world, because if you don't develop that growth mindset, the child will not be able to focus on this teaching learning, which is with a distance. You have lost that physical touch. You have lost that emotional touch with the kid. They are far away from you. You have to teach them judgment and decision making, because they initially they were in school. You were able to give them value education. You were able to give them moral education. But now they are at home with their parents. So where is that connect? In your teaching every day, you need to touch these points. You need to tell them how to make judgments, how to make decisions, which has become very difficult in this world. Virtual teaching has taken place and the children are far away from you. So it is difficult for you to teach them. But these are the skills you need to develop in them. We really don't know when they are going to come back to school. People say August. Now August has come. They say September. Then they say October. So we really don't know when we are going to be physically getting involved with the kids. It is really difficult time, very difficult time. Now, when you talk about this, we have to develop that interpersonal communication skill also. Now the child is at home. He cannot communicate with people. So you have to develop that interpersonal communication skill, which is now taking a backstage, because the child is only interacting with parent. He is getting whatever he wants at home. But what about the society? What about the society? Imagine the last 4-5 months, they are away from their peers, they are away from their friends, they are away from their relatives. So where is their interpersonal communication, which has taken a backseat? So we all as educators have to play a very important role. Again, when they were in school, we were developing their leadership skills. Now at home, he is the only leader at home. So where is the crowd? So who's going to train him about being a leader? So again, our responsibility as educator is again has taken a back foot, because we are away from them. So now you cannot say that you are the monitor, take care. You are the head boy, you take care. Where is the school? Where are the children? Again, diversity and culture, which we were giving them in our morning assembly, in our programs. Though we are conducting morning assembly, virtual morning assembly, where is the crowd? So how do you give them? It is becoming difficult. Technology, everybody is touching. I know it was a difficult task. Zoom, WebEx, I don't know how many platforms we went on. Ultimately, Zoom uncle was very kind enough and we were able to handle it very nicely. Last is, we have to embrace the change. We have to work on that. And we have to prepare our future citizens with all these things. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sandhya, ma'am. To summarize what you said, that creativity, a very important skill, critical thinking, or typically teaching a student how to think, the process of decision making, and how does a decision happen in your brain, and why do you learn? We have to make them more conscious about what's all going around them and to the process of teaching and learning. And you have to give them a stepwise manual that this is the way you learn. So try to gauge yourself that whether you're learning or not. So decision making has to be taught. We're all becoming introverts, and interpersonal skills, which are now very, very, very critical, have actually taken an absolute backseat, because every child at home is the leader. So leadership skills, interpersonal skills are not there. But yes, one good development that has happened, that value education, which was a utopian dream of every educator, happened very nicely during the lockdown, because the best teacher for value education is the parent. And he enabled that very well. And the child is the only leader. Diversity and culture and embracing change. And embracing change, we all need to understand that the kind of pace of change is very high. So at this point, a decision about your life gets even more critical. So trying to make pace with the pace of change is something that you need to teach them. So thank you so much, Sandhya ma'am. Let's listen to the next speaker for today, Mr. Vinod Punia, HOD Mathematics, BRJD Public School, Gurugram, Rajasthan. Vinodji, over to you for the next 2 minutes.
Yeah, thank you, Daksh sir. Hello, everyone. It is an honor to be here with you people here. I would like to thank the organizer from Blue World Web Talk and personality presenting today's meeting. As we all know that our world is being shaped by the rapid technology changes nowadays. Students are in such a type of job markets. I don't think their grandparents even know that what type of jobs the nowadays the children are doing, the upcoming generation is doing. As we all know that the world is becoming more and more complicated day by day. So creative and innovative thinking is the main path by which a student can solve many type of futuristic problems. Critical thinking, good communication skills, problem solving methods, and this type of such type of methods can give the skill driven society to our upcoming generation. A clear and a structured effort should be done to inculcate such type of major skill among the students and the teachers also. I think today mostly developed countries that adopted the scientific approach. We are also developing, but slowly and gracefully, as we can see that from the few countries we are inculcating, we are bringing some armaments also. So I think inculcating scientific thinking in our students can lead them to accept the major challenges in their life. We have to do at least technological skills also. We have to develop technological skills. But as compared to developed countries, we are not doing so much in advanced way. So doing a lot of hard work to do, we have to do also the smart work also along with the hard work. This is only possible in the advanced technology. It makes any work more perfect, more smart, and technology will enable us to achieve the desired goals and helps us a lot in building global networking also. One more important skill is there, that is strong social skill. One must have good emotional and mental health. It directly links in children that how they will grow up and what type of life they will live in their adulthood. Social skill removes the gender gaps also. The one and the most important skill, I think, that is entrepreneurship nowadays. Innovative and creative ideas can lead one towards entrepreneurship, and it co-ops with others also. So promotion of entrepreneurship should be done in our education system. Entrepreneurship skill contain a broad range of various skill sets, like that of many skill sets are, that is teaching skills, leadership, business management, creative thinking. Developing the entrepreneurship skill means developing many type of set of skills, like that strategic thinking, planning, time management, branding, marketing, customer service, teamwork, communication, and a lot more also. With this all, I am ending my words. Thanks to everyone.
Thank you so much, Vinodji. Before we move on to the next speaker, in every call that Blub curates, we try to get people from the biggest variety gap, which would be geographically different, which would be economically different, which would be demographically different, so that in each call, we get a very inclusive understanding of things. On one of the aspects that Vinodji said, that time management, one of the schools in Guwahati, I think the Springdale School in Guwahati, Assam, started a very innovative activity that you all can do in your school very easily. They started their kids, gave an assignment to their kids that start building a balance sheet of time. Consider time as money that you have at hand and build a balance sheet of it, that what did you spend wisely, what's an investment, what's an expense, and what's an expenditure, to understand money management and time management at the same time. And they've been doing it very nicely. We'll be sharing some of those snippets on our social media that you can actually go and look. In the initial talks, we selected 100 such ideas, and these 100 ideas are available on all the different social media platforms of LoveWorld. You can go and look at them and even implement them in within your institutions. And if you have something amazing, share it with us. We'll share it with nearly 5,500 schools across the globe. So thank you so much, Vinodji. Let's listen to the next speaker for today, Dr. Nisha Sharma, who's the principal Omkar Residential School, Bhavnagar, Gujarat. Nisha ji, over to you for the next 2 minutes. You'll have to unmute yourself.
Thank you, Team LoveWorld. And even I would like to greet everybody on this platform today. I have a few very important aspects today to tell you all. And one of them is, as you all know, we all are talking about technology. In technology, I would insist on teaching coding in school levels. So coding is a very important aspect, according to me, which should be taught at a very younger age students. And along with coding, when we are talking of interpersonal skills, I would also like to put my emphasis on, character building. Interpersonal skills we have talked. I would emphasize on intrapersonal skills and character building of a child. See, we are moving on technological path, but parallel to that, we also have to put our emphasis on, molding your child for its better character in today's world. So this all skills would be probably helping us to move further on our path. Next, which I would emphasize is research-based schools. We all were talking about research-based colleges, but this thoughts, curious children are very much curious, and they have ample of good ideas to implement for further coming generations, So we have to found some research-based schools which are highly important. And all this should be done in controlled conditions. When we leave child on technological path, many times they lose their control. So in controlled conditions, parents and schools together, they have to work now. It's not going to be like children will be left only on the shoulders of the schools. It's not only schools' responsibility. Sometimes parents act like that. So in controlled conditions, we have to work. Another, while we were talking of emotional intelligence, I would also like to put my light on tolerance power. We all have to strengthen the tolerance power, because I feel today's generation is losing its tolerance power, and even we too sometimes. So this all skills I feel are very, very important. And for schools, future ready students we have to prepare. We don't have to see to contemporary what is going on in today's world, because it will be outdated out after a few years. So today what we have to focus is, we have to focus on future ready students, and where children, when they are out of the school, they are able to decide on their own which trait they are going to choose for their future. So basically, research-based schools, coding and communication skills, collaboration, and many other previous speakers have already put light on the things which I would also admit to that they are really very important. But yes, character building, I feel for every nation, till grade 4, we should focus strongly on it, because good citizens will always take their country to a very good part, right? So this is what, on this key notes only, I would like to end my session. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Nishaji. To summarize, the teaching coding in schools, character building and intrapersonal skills, and character building is very important now, because kids are in isolation at the moment. And when they are in isolation, that's when character building becomes even more critical, because you're not getting exposed to what kids around you are doing. Research-based schools from research-based colleges, because the kind of content we need cannot be a lecture anymore. It'll have to be much more than a lecture. It cannot be information delivery. It has to be engagement. And when we talk of engagement, the content has to keep renewing itself again and again. Tolerance should be taught in making students self-reliant in decision-making for their lives. Thank you so much, ma'am. Let's now listen to the next speaker for today, Ms. Namita Joshi, former Vice Principal, DPS, Ranipur, Haridwar. Namita ji, over to you for the next 2 minutes. You'll have to unmute.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you, team Blub, to invite me. I retired as a vice principal last year from Delhi Public School, Ranipur, and I have a 39-year experience of teaching and, of course, many years of administrative service. Of course, many of you have covered up most of the topics that I had actually thought of, like having mental health issues that are very, very important. But I'll just like to emphasize on one thing, that is a collaboration. The fact is that these days the children are staying at home. They are self-centered in isolation. So they have to be taught to work in collaboration, in the sense that they should be able to work with people of all backgrounds, ages, religions, political options, and also the fact that I would if rather say that synergy has become today modern day's buzzword, synergy. And not only that, they have to recognize, but when I talk about collaboration, I talk about that they should, when they work as a team, they should be able to appreciate each person's strength, weakness, and also accept and accept the results that are available. Resolve the conflicting among the teams. This is one very, very important, is the collaboration part, because this, as a result of being children staying at home, can become a little more, take a back seat, because they'll be all individualistic these days. Then another thing that is very important, as a teacher of biology, now they are in the new education policy, they have a very, very welcome change, is the changing, shifting. You can have take any subjects, any subject. So what I personally feel is the fact that a teacher as a biology should become a very, very important subject for children, because they generally tend to leave it out. I've seen in all my years' experience, their children tend to leave out biology. They prefer those subjects which are give them fast work. They'll be able to employ faster. Then another thing that is there, that I talked about, I think somebody talked about the entrepreneurial skills. So they have to be creative. That is very, very important these days, because of the lack of job opportunities, children should be able to be creative, create their own jobs to start, to build up startups and things like that. So these are one of my most important things, as of course the collaboration part, entrepreneurial skills, and of course teaching of biology and other subjects, which should not be neglected in the seeing the present day circumstances. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Namita ji. Collaboration, self-centered kid right now being flourished across the nation, across the globe, because he is at home. Every need is being catered to. Teamwork, changing subjects as per choices. This is something that is very good, because multidisciplinary approach is what we need right now. And some subjects don't find takers. That's absolutely a reality. And what we need to right now do is build subject modules which are small, and which student can actually experience in a small duration of time and taste it, that whether he wants to continue with it or not. So we'll have to give him option to, you know, do a lot of subject tasting. Like there's a wine tasting, so here it should be subject tasting. Then go and get a feel of it, whether you want to have it or not. So thank you so much, Namita ma'am. Let's hear it from the next speaker. Miss Namrata Majhail, principal of the Orchid School, Pune, Maharashtra. Ma'am, over to you.
Yeah, very good morning to all of you. What a pleasure to have you all of you there and listening to all of you. Thank you, Daksh, and all the eminent personalities. I mean, the views expressed are amazing and very relevant. In my experience as an educationist and as a principal right now, what I see that if you just Google it, you'll find all the skills which are required for any person or of this generation and maybe future generations to really take care of. But I'll just go by experiences which I have and I'll just sum it up in the time given to me. I feel it's very important that we handle our anxieties before we ask children to handle their anxieties, because we are more anxious about future because we are ourselves not equipped. So the skilling starts from the adults themselves. So we need to equip and skill ourselves first of all what is mentioned in all Google, all the books which are written on the future skills required, keeping in mind the future jobs. So I think children need to be very original in their ideas, because for some time we've been used to cut, copy, paste from the Google, Wikipedia and all. I think this is the time to be original and be confident about your ideas, because world is looking for the reflective kind of thinking and reasoning from the children, which is solution oriented. And innovation, entrepreneurship, and also to preempt what is going to happen when they are taking a course of action. It's very important for them to understand that anything unexpected can happen, and they're mentally and physically prepared for that. To handle their anxieties, curiosities, that is very important for them, because we are giving them options after options. You know, NEP has just been released. There's so much given. Teachers are nervous and confused. You know, what is that one thing which I should pick up? And as the leaders, we are not also equally nervous that, you know, if I have to start from coding, which I talk about in my classroom or in my assemblies, do I myself know about it? So then, you know, handling all that new information is also something which the children need to learn to, you know, be skilled about. Very simple things like giving feedback and taking feedback, handling conflict. This is very important, that, you know, being humble and humane enough to understand others' point of view, to accept, as one of the speakers has very rightly said, the social and cultural realities on the other side, and be able to empathize with them. This is that very important skill which I feel we need to take care of. Change, so much is changing. Are we equipping ourselves and the children to handle that change and grab all the opportunities which are coming, you know, in their way and our way also, to, you know, manage the education system within the school and country at large? Are we aware enough? Are we updated enough? If we are not, then how can I, you know, guide the children? So that skill is very important at adult level and at the children level. So they should Google, definitely, but for knowledge sake, not to get confused about, you know, this is also available, that is also available. So, you know, there's so much on the plate where to start eating from is the most difficult thing now for the children. So that is where they need to be aware of their own potential. I think that.
Thank you so much, Namrata ma'am. To summarize what you said, handle our anxiety first and then move towards kids, because hum as a generation, we are mature. Abhi, we are in the kind of age where hamari anxiety bahut jaldi upar chali jati hai, and that has to be handled first before we actually go to the kid. And time to be original and not rely on Google content or Google knowledge. Try to go in depth in the subject that you actually love, because we would need not just specialists in the coming time, but we'll need super specialists. So try to get complete skill and the sensibility of the subject before you go into the career selection process. Preemptive understanding, enabling new policy is also a big challenge for the leaders, because when policy makers make a policy, they keep in view all the aspects and the different ways it will impact the ecosystem. But when it comes on to a, you know, on-ground fighter or implementer, this is where the challenge happens, that out of this big pile of policies, where do you start? What do you pick up first? And opportunity analysis and acceptance. And to be very frank, it's right now the so much on the plate syndrome that's been, you know, affecting everybody. So thank you so much, Ramataji. Let's listen to the next speaker, Ms. Ruby Sharma, founder principal, Om Academic School, Faridabad, Haryana. Ruby ma'am, over to you. I think, okay, there's some technical error. Let's listen to Dr. Anita Matthew, Principal, Kochi Business School, Kochi, Kerala. Anita ma'am, over to you for the next 2 minutes.
Very good morning to all of you. Hope I'm audible to all. Okay, thank you. I have been in the higher education for the last 25 years, and grooming MBA students for the employers. So the confusion we are raising here today, how do we make them future ready? What are the skills that will make them competent and acceptable by the industry, right? These are some of the questions and which have been discussed at the higher education level. And if I look back at my 25 years of experience and now when I'm listening to each of you while you're in school, those significant years of their schooling with all of you, I feel each one of us has a lot of role to play in their life and the careers they choose, because eventually we want them to be successful. Now, how we define success, how do we teach them what is success, is again a very, very significant point that that we all need to discuss. So some of the, I mean, I've been listening to all the speakers and many of those points have already been discussed. But some of the points which I would like to highlight is, yes, taking from my earlier speaker, embracing change. Change at all levels, at personal level, at professional level. Like if I look at our personal, you know, personal life also, many of the institutions of confidence, trust, or probably marriage has also undergone a change, like, right? So these institutions of which has been, I would say, which had stood the time and took the awe of audience and people and society has crumbled. So whether it is relationships, whether it is marriages, whether it is, you know, we talked about collaboration, team building, all that, the basic level, I mean, the customer and the, you know, the organization, right? The basic element of trust between people have you know, crumbled or continuously is shaking. So there are institutions again which are legal or maybe ethical, which challenge, which question, and we are continuously through our experience trying to teach students. Second point which I thought is crisis management skills. Now this is something which we don't talk about at all. Now how do we teach that? How do we tell them that? Continuing with the crisis management is shelf life of any education, shelf life of any skill. However hard we might say that this is going to be relevant for the next 10 years, next 5 years, all this, the students have to be, the children have to be told that, you know, these are again, will be subject to environmental tests. Diversity and cultural intelligence, you know, we have varied kind of people with different personalities and features which you have to accept. Startup skills. Today as a mother, when I have my 21-year-old child who says that, you know, I'll work for some years and think of a new organization, I have a puzzled face, because I have always thought that, you know, being employed is a better feature than, you know, starting something new. So startup skills, nothing wrong about it. Start from the scratch. Let it be, so the gestation period is maybe 5 years, 10 years, but we are there with you. Plus, please try. So moving from an employee orientation to an entrepreneurial start, you know, or startup attitude, startup skills. And we talked about resilience, tolerance. Let us fail. Let us accept failure. We'll only see success after 10 years, but let's build up that skill in them, right? Emotional intelligence. Now, how do we teach their curiosity to be in state? This is not to be shut down. How do we?
Thank you so much, Anita ma'am. The time was over. To summarize what you said, that defining and teaching success and success ki benchmarking. This is very important, because bahut sara frustration and bahut sara emotional distraught is because of the kind of standards that we set in their brain, that yes, when you have achieved this, this is the point that you start dancing. Before this, only keep toiling. And second, social values have crumbled, and as a society, we are facing a lot of big challenges which we are not able to handle even at the moment. Crisis management skills, because once a skill, the next point that you said, that the shelf life of a skill, so the kind of skills that all of us had, they have actually expired their shelf life, and we are right now managing a crisis to find the right fit for us, for each one of us. And diversity and cultural intelligence, because we need global citizens, so we need to always have respect and understanding about the kind of cultural changes that we'll see. And startup skills. You want to say something, you can take a minute again for sure. You'll have to unmute.
If you look at Maslow's hierarchy, we talk about going from physiological level to self-actualization level, right? Now, experience has shown me that at any point of time, that pyramid itself will crumble, and you might have to start from the scratch. And when she said, let's learn with joy, right? So if I have been in a comfortable room, and tomorrow the employer says bye-bye, and I have to start an alternative careers, alternative, paths for you. Be ready to take that with and take life. I mean, it's like lemons. Please make lemonade of it. Thank you.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Ishari. So these were all the speakers for today that we had. So we got a very nice idea on how do you think and perceive the kind of skills that we'll need in the future. Let's take some closing thoughts from Rishikesh ji, and then we'll go towards the conclusion of the talk. Rishikesh ji, over to you for the next 3 minutes for the concluding statements of today's roundtable.
Thank you very much. I appreciate all the speakers who have talked on various valid points. I think that is the future, and I think all the children would be very happy under you in order to learn and move ahead in your career. So I think the most important aspect which has come is one of the speaker mentioned about the crisis management. I think that is the that is an important skill which comes really comes out. And since COVID has been a crisis and we are able to overcome it, so that is a live example. Also, Daksh, you mentioned about something called as a super specialist. So in fact, in the fourth industrial revolution and the World Economic Forum, it is said that gig economy will take over, and you need to be one step ahead of everyone, like the story of gazelle and the lion. Every day, both of them wake up, and lion wants to eat, and gazelle wants to be saved. So I think that is very relevant, and we need to be very sure and ready for the future. Other important aspect about learning is basically that will transform, and learner needs to be passive learners, and they need to become more of an active, self-directed, lifelong learners. I think that is the next strategy, and most of the students as well as higher education candidates who are actually pursuing their graduation or post-graduation, maybe they would like to have that kind of motivation in order to move ahead. Also, like in China, where I was there for a year, I saw many Chinese university students going to something called as an English corner and learning basic English skills and speaking English skills. So I think these kind of co-learning spaces we need to find in our schools and colleges, where people, like-minded students, can actually go into these co-learning spaces, and a lot of emerging technology experience centers where they can actually learn and understand. Even small example like Alexa or maybe Google Home can be used as a teacher, because they never stop answering. And teachers have a fixed time that teacher will come for 45 minutes only, but Alexa never stops. So students can use those kind of technologies. Then also a lot of important is the students continuously strive to add values in themselves. I think the value point, which some of the speakers mentioned, is very important. Present in all of us, and when we are a small child, we are able to learn new languages, maybe 3-4 languages during our initial months, and also a lot of cognitive aspects and the psychomotor skills we pick up very easily. But learning becomes only challenge when a student joins school. So why this situation happens? And I think the new education policy has actually hit at the right point, and I think the future is bright for the country, and teachers like you are, I think, the future. And lastly, most of the teaching learning happens because there is a Sanskrit shloka, and I just wanted to comment on that a student learns 1/4 from the teacher, 1/4 from the fellow students, 1/4 from his or her own intelligence, and 1/4 time. So all of us are basically contributing to that, and I think that is the thing. And lastly, I'll conclude with what Sir Isaac Newton had said once. He said that if I have seen further than others, it is by standing upon the shoulders of the giant. And we need to see the experience, see the giants, how they are moving, and then basically standing on their shoulders and move ahead. Thank you very much. Thank you, Daksh and Blubworld.
Thank you so much, Rishikesh ji. So before this talk comes to an end, and I would just like to share some food for thought so that when we meet next, there's something more engaging, something more entertaining, something more engrossing to talk about. Whenever we as a society face existential challenges, we come together. We start communicating. We start empathizing. We start listening. We start experimenting. So as an educationist, this is the perfect time that you have got the whole world in front of you as a laboratory. So if you ever wanted to innovate, ever wanted to experiment, ever wanted to do something new in the field of education, this is the perfect time. You're sitting on a golden spot. Don't lose it. Because samaj bahut kam baar sunne ko tayyar hota hai. It's very less in our human history that you actually can go and find instances where we as a society listened and experimented. And this is a golden period for all of us to experiment. So don't lose that. And more importantly, what you can observe right now, nobody else can. So try building a habit of writing an observation paper every evening. Only 100, 200 words doesn't make a difference, but write. Because our future generations will actually be asking you a question that when you are not supposed to do anything, what were you doing? Because that's where innovation really lies. So I hope you enjoyed the last 30, 40 minutes that you spent with Blubworld. If you did, and if you want to attend the future sessions, you can open your audio, say a big yes, and thank you so much for being a part of the Blubworld Web Talk 76th episode. Thank you, people. Namaste.
Thank you. Amazing, and yes, we would want to be.
Yeah. Daksh, it was very nice. Such lovely viewpoints from everyone. And I have a session at 11 that I'm presenting to the parents and to my teachers. And I have taken so many points from here. So it's really such varied points from everyone, and all culminating into the, you know, where we want to be. Sure. So lovely. Thank you so much for inviting me
and
for this August gathering.
My pleasure.
Thank you, Blubworld. Thank you, Blubworld, and all the participants who shared very, very significant observations. Thank you so much.
Thank you. A lot of things
we have learned. And to be very frank, you are very true. Observation is what we should jot it down. Because some of them asked, did you face this problem when you were in school? One of my child, when I conducted a meeting, the child asked, ma'am, did you face this when you were in school and in class 3? I said, no, dear. We were fortunate enough. We never missed our school. So we'll come back again.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Hope
thank
that
you
all come back again. And with lots and lots more of energy and enthusiasm, I hope that we all become once again that happy, that amazing little society that we were. Thank you, people. Thank you so much from Blubworld.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.